Where in the world is Edward Snowden? Well, that parlor game kept the attention of news outlets this week, as several nations considered Snowden's request for asylum, including Venezuela, Nicaragua, and now Bolivia. Britain's Guardian newspaper broke the original Snowden story, but things took an odd turn this past week when its sister paper, The Observer, ran a front-page story that claimed European officials had reached a secret deal with the NSA to turn over private data to the USA. Now, that sure sounds scandalous, but here's the thing. The article based its claims on a single, very unreliable source, a notorious conspiracy theorist named Wayne Madsen, whom reporter Jamie Doward never even spoke with. And not surprisingly, the article was eventually retracted, but not before it made the rounds on the internet, even receiving a coveted Drudge Report link. So what does it say that a newspaper as reputable as The Observer would base its so-called scoop on such a shaky source? Joining me from Los Angeles, Michael Moynihan, columnist for Newsweek and the Daily Beast, who helped debunk this story. Michael, tell us a little bit about what drew your attention when you saw Michael Madsen being the sole source in this story.
I have come across Wayne Madsen in the past. I mean, he pops up on these television networks affiliated with government propaganda ministries like Iranian Press TV and Russia Today. So when I saw that name, I did a double, probably a triple take to wonder if the Guardian Observer was actually using this source that I've come across so many times. Now, to keep in mind that Wayne Madsen is not just a journalist with sort of strange or extreme views. I mean, these are very extreme views. I mean, he's a 9/11 truther. He believes that the attacks in Norway, the terrorist attacks of Anders Breivik, were carried out by Israel, that the USS Cole was bombed by Israel. He has some very strange views about President Obama, et cetera. So when I saw that, I started reading the piece and said, good God, this is the only source in this piece. Do they not know who he is, or did they not use Google?
Well, it sounds like the definition of an unreliable source. What was The Observer's response when they retracted? And I understand Salon did a reposting, and that's who got the Drudge link, and they were reluctant to take the piece down entirely. Why?
Yeah, I mean, essentially what happens is the Guardian Observer pulled the piece fairly quickly. I mean, you've talked a lot about social media on the show today. This was a social media response. I was one of the ones leading the charge. This kind of filters back to The Observer. They pull the piece. But here's the thing that should also be mentioned is they're a print newspaper. So that had actually gone to the printer. The people that read The Observer, the Sunday edition of The Guardian, got their print edition, the first printing of that, with a big picture of Wayne Madsen on the front. So they were already done. They were already in a bit of trouble here. Salon, on the other hand, who had sort of cannibalized the story, because so much of journalism these days is aggregating other people's so-called scoops, had posted this, had got that coveted Drudge link, which, provides enormous amounts of traffic, and didn't take the story down, but did post a note that said, well, the Observer is looking into the source here, but we're keeping this up. And, at the time, the only thing I can imagine is that they're going to take it down. You get all this traffic, and that's what people are after.
And that's the larger civic cost here. I mean, briefly, as we do the autopsy of a conspiracy theory that gets mainstream, what are the civic costs and the incentives that may be out of whack for people in reposting this junk?
Well, I mean, the incentives are, of course, is that, the Guardian had this cover story revealed. It was a revelation. Now, even if you looked at the story, even if you trusted what this guy was saying, it was based on publicly available documents. Nothing was revealed here. But in the sort of sweepstakes of trying to get clicks and get involved in this NSA story, people are putting out stuff that might not be true, might have to be walked back. But the problem is this sort of seeps into the groundwater. And we've seen this with Madsen in the past, who's made a claim that the Guardian picked up in 2002 about Venezuela and about the coup against Chavez that has made its way into academic books. I wrote a piece about this and sort of traced how this infected actual journalism. Because people say they don't see Wayne Madsen later. They say The Guardian, which is a very reputable newspaper, very good newspaper, and The Observer is also. So that is ultimately the problem here, is you get, these people who are trawling for clicks and, hits and viewers, and ultimately it gets the stamp of quality of a real newspaper, and then, it filters out.
I want to bring in our panel here on this conversation, because one of the real problems of our time is policing hyperpartisan media, or looking at the ways that conspiracy theories get mainstreamed and seep into the groundwater, as Michael said. What are the cautionary tales about some of the repostings we see, and what we know as journalists largely working in digital, that there is an incentive sometimes to post the salacious, the fundamentally untrue, because of confirmation bias, rather than something that's a bit more sober? Let's start with Errol.
Well, look, this is journalism school, first semester 101. If you don't have two independent sources, you don't have a story. And the reality is, what I think we don't do enough of is really sort of teach people what goes on in a newsroom when there is a lot of competitiveness, when there is a lot of energy running through the room, there is a desire to sort of break something big. People's emotions take over, and they throw all of their training to the side. And unless there's an editor or a publisher or somebody there, you know, senior, you know, newsroom leadership is what we call it, to say, wait a minute, don't do this. You know, it's better to be right than to be first sometimes. Mm-hmm. If you can't do that, you're not really running a newsroom.
I mean, it is basic, but one thing about the rise of partisan media, Jackie, is that confirmation bias can slide towards conspiracy theories. And that can go around the world before the truth gets out of bed.
Again, that's why due diligence is so important. That is why. I mean, I know we can say, oh, it's so fast. Oh, there's too much information. End of the day, due diligence matters. People don't remember. People remember your big scoops. They'll remember them more if they're wrong.
Yeah, yes. Very quickly, Josh.
I would just put a silver lining on this and say that the upside of this is that now the news business is self-correcting. The story only lasted a day, and you had sharp guys out there like Mike Moynihan pointing out where the story went wrong. So even though these things get out faster, they also get solved faster and allow reporters to sort of operate it in a newsroom that is high pressure.
Social media ends up leading that charge. I mean, it ends up being there's a crowdsourced correction as well, but only if people pick up on it. And the danger is that there are enough dupes out there that these things do end up getting put in the history books and treated as official documents, as Michael Moynihan pointed out.